Good morning, everyone. As we count our blessings of being able to meet and still connecting, we are mindful of the measures that are keeping our community safe in our social distancing. Thanks to our musicians who are keeping the music alive, and unfortunately we still can't have any congregational singing, so all the hymns will be sung by the choir only. Part of our care is supporting St Matthew's by direct debit, by using the tap and go machine at the back of the church or the retiring collection bags as you depart. The Lord be with you. Our first hymn is King of Glory, King of Peace, to be sung by the choir only.
Good morning.
Good morning, Peter.
The Lord is here. His spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And
as we remember so many congregations and places where they're not able to meet at all, and remembering how important it is to be in touch with people when we can, to at least acknowledge each other and share the peace of Christ. So peace be with you. And to the lovely choir and organist. So welcome as we bring our daily lives and the life of the world to share in the light and hope that God offers. And today, remembering the theme of harmony, communication and respect, we acknowledge the first peoples of this land and all who call Australia home. We give thanks for God's loving care for families across the world and ask God's special blessing and protection for all who are in our hearts. Amen.
And we continue. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
As we remember Christ and his friends sharing the message of hope, we ask for his gifts of forgiveness, healing and strength. God, our Creator, you have made us one family on earth. but we find ourselves separated instead of connected. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus, our Redeemer, we share your forgiveness, but our world is sharing fear and anxiety. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Living Spirit of God, your mercies rise new every morning. Help us to share the light of hope in challenging times. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God forgive us, Christ renew us, and the Spirit enable us to live in love. Amen. Let us pray as we pray for peace and harmony in our world, praying that all people may live free from violence, in safety and security, and with hope for the future. Amen. Will you please be seated. Is that working? It is. It's a miracle. There we are. It says here in our order of service today that we are introducing Cathy Carden, who is chaplain, to Cathedral College. And of course, this is one introduction which needs very little introduction at all, because it's as though Cathy Carden has suddenly appeared. But can you say, tell us, Cathy, how long have you been at St Matthew's? What about that?
About 18 years.
Here we are, so welcome.
Thank you.
And I know that when I first met you here, that you're a teacher. And how long have you been a teacher?
Gosh, these questions. That's about 18 years too, actually, yes.
Wow.
Yes.
And you're married?
Yes, married to Mark, who I sometimes see when he's not at St Matthew's. And we've got three children. Our daughter Julie lives here in Albury. She works at the cinema centre. And we've got a son, his wife and granddaughter who live in Tasmania, Andy, and another son, Nathan, who's in Melbourne.
And I think you also have the joy of... I've seen you pushing a pram in pictures.
Yes.
So is that a late little surprise, or is it a green grandmother, is that right?
And a grandmother, yes. Did there I not are. Mention the granddaughter, sorry.
So that's, and I know when I first met you here, you were teaching within the Catholic system.
Yes, at St. Augustine's in Wodonga. Yep.
And then you've moved from that position to where?
I went to Cathedral College in Wangaratta.
Mm-hmm. And what position do you have there?
When I went down there, which is 6 years ago now, I took on a role of in special ed and learning enhancement, and I did some religious education teaching there as well. But then about 4 years ago, the principal at the school asked if I would be the chaplain in the school, part-time chaplain, part-time continuing with the special education area. So I started that 3 years ago. At the time, they talked to me about possibly being ordained, and at the time I said no.
How wise. nevertheless, as time has gone on, I mean, you've obviously grown into the role in chaplaincy there.
Yes, yeah. So I just love the chaplaincy role and the pastoral care that involves. I've got the opportunity to teach religious education, but we also take a chapel service in the junior school every fortnight. We have another ordained chaplain at the school as well, so I work really closely with him. But it's the role on the pastoral care team in my chaplaincy role is what I really love, and that the privilege of working with families, particularly during difficult times in their life. You know, we've had loss of students and parents, and we also run a program every year for students whose families have separated and they're experiencing grief and loss. And in the role as the chaplain, you've just got an opportunity to minister to the little people when their families and lives are going through something. The parents are often grieving themselves and experiencing their own emotions, and just to have a little space for the little people to express that is a really important part of what I enjoy doing.
Well, I know that many priests, as they go around leading congregations, end up driving a long way, and they end up having two or three people in the whole congregation. But as a leader of your own congregation in terms of ministry, I think your congregation is actually much larger, isn't that right?
Yeah, so that's how I feel, that my congregation is the 1,000 students we've got at Cathedral College, along with their families. So I feel like we've got 3,000 people there who've chosen to come to an Anglican school. So I very much see that they're part of my congregation. Yeah.
Well, I think we all recognise what a wonderful opportunity that is to help form the experience of young people and to give them an understanding of the Christian tradition.
That's right.
And I know that you've grown up in a family. We probably have more Anglican credentials than anyone else in the diocese. Your uncle, Bishop Ken Short, was my boss, and he had a wonderful model of ministry. He was bishop to the forces, but also he was the Dean of Sydney. His wife, Gloria Short, was one of the youngest winners of the Sun Aria, and we used to call them Uncle Ken and Auntie Gloria. And they had a real family way of gathering community. And I know that in terms of warmth and humanity, that you certainly have those gifts as well. I'm just wondering, in almost concluding now, it's quite good, isn't it? welcome to the hot seat. In terms of sharing a Christian message among young people today, what's the thing you'd most like them to walk away with after they've perhaps left their school and gone into the turmoil of modern life?
I have a little mantra, and for me it's providing a positive experience of church, which people equate church with God, so I guess that positive experience of God. So throughout my anything I do at the school, it's about the people there not being scared to come through the church doors. A lot of their parents and grandparents have had negative experiences of church, so for me it's about building up the warmth and outreach of a place where they can go, where they will receive love and kindness and care, and gradually building a need. We all have a need for spiritual experiences in our lives, and for them to know that church can be a really big part of that. And we just see it evolving. It's not the sort of ministry where, you know, you see people becoming a Christian every week, but we just know through the involvement of the families and the children and their responses as they journey through their school that this is an important part that goes with them and stays with them later on.
Well, as you look forward to whatever's happening next, and I think that's the thing. I mean, ordination really is not so much as having a bishop lay his hands on you and calling you father or mother or anything else. It's about the recognition of a ministry within your own community. That's what it originally was, and I think that's what it is today as well. So I'm sure that as I've seen you with young people, and certainly I've seen you at work in pastoral care up close when you've been brought up to help at Trinity, that you've certainly got that recognition, and God's certainly blessing others through you, and no doubt blessing you as well as you do so. So again, thank you so much for still being part of St. Matthew's. We're loaning you, of course. When you're not here, it's not because you've given up church for Lent. But what are you doing when you're not here, apart from possibly sleeping in? But no, you might be somewhere else. Where are you when you're not here?
So as part of the journey, it was sort of made... I just felt God was really working in me, whereas I initially said, no, I didn't want ordination. It was actually Maureen Beattie who explained to me the importance of being able to minister to the sacraments for people all the way through their life, from the beginning to the end, whenever the end might be. So I did then start a process of stepping forward with the possibility of ordination. So that's what I'm in at the moment. And it has been delayed a bit with COVID and changes in bishops and things like that. But part of the formation and development of that is being getting experiences in different parishes. So two Sundays a month I'm out at Rutherglen Parish with Father Scott Jessop, which is lovely, realising that he began his journey here at St Matthew's as well. So two Sundays a month I'm out there, which it's as much as it's really busy time for me at the moment, I'm really enjoying it out there. And I just feel really strongly about being, when you're part of a diocese, understanding and knowing the strengths and areas and different parishes across the diocese. So it's been another opportunity for me to extend that as well, explore that.
Well, just beautiful. Well, thank you very much. And on Harmony Day, to thank you for all the bridges that you build in a world that's got lots of barriers, and also the special bridges you're building for young people into their own future, into a more inclusive, compassionate and kinder world. So thank you very much. And we might give you a little round of encouragement. There we are. We can do that. You know. There we are. To ask you to lead us in the reading. Thank you.
Yes, I would. Thank you. Our first reading today is a reading from the book of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
might like to stand for the reading of the Gospel.
Lord be with you.
Yes.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light." After Jesus had said this, he departed and hid from them. For the Gospel, the good news of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ.
My words be to the glory of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the power of the Spirit. Amen. Would you please be seated? Harmony Day has a ring to it, doesn't it? You might remember the song, I think most of us will. There might be some young people who have yet to hear it, but perhaps you'll come around for the third or fourth time. Do you remember that song in the 1970s? Seems like yesterday, doesn't it? From the New Seekers. "I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony." When my twin brother and myself were doing talent quests and wearing white suits with platform shoes, and then I was in charge of the na-na-na-na-na. But it was a great song. It was groundbreaking. "I'd like to teach the world to sing. I'd like to hold it in my arms and keep it company." It was groundbreaking. There was a film clip with children and young people from all over the world at a time when really the world was very much thinking about little bits and particular nations and holding on to things. And there was this wonderful film clip on a mountain with young people. And it was about the success of multiculturalism. But in actual fact, it started as a Coca-Cola ad. "I'd like to buy the world a Coke," actually it started off, which I really didn't know about, but horrified really. It was really just about marketing. It was an ad, though, that went all over the world for Coke, except in South Africa, they asked whether they'd take the young black people out of it, because they liked the whole world, but as long as it was on their terms. I'm pleased to say the Coca-Cola people refused to do so and actually withdrew from South Africa. But you can see the problem. You don't solve the world problem just by writing a song about it. Marketing can take you only so far. Sometimes people imagine they've arrived at their destination when they've got the brochure in their hand. Harmony Day is not really a celebration of harmony at all, but began in 1999, coinciding with the United Nations International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. And it commemorated the day when police in Sharpeville in South Africa opened fire on a peaceful anti-apartheid demonstration, killing 69 people. Now, that doesn't sound very harmonious, does it? But of course, that sounds like hard work to do something about that. So our marketing geniuses decided that we won't go for a day of anti-discrimination, we'll go for Harmony Day, because that sounds more positive. How good is that, as they say in some places? So Harmony Day is really just about marketing, but it's really about, it should be about, creating a positive change. In Harmony Day, we're not really invited to a celebration. We're invited to a working bee. Now, for those people who might be fearful you're about to be put on the parish council when the next meeting happens, it's just like that, because being given a job sounds much more difficult than going along to a party. But that's exactly what Jesus has in mind. When Jesus' friends were invited to join that particular journey, it's the same sort of wake-up call that the friends of Jesus had, though, when they were trying to understand what it meant to be a part of the Christian community. It's great to be with someone who can heal everyone and feed everyone, and in fact provide a whole lot of wine when there's no wine around. It's like being part of a big healing expo or a mass catering miracle. It's a fantastic part of that sort of party. But Jesus calls them to so much more. Because that sort of stuff, waving your wand around the world, making it better, is the stuff of fairy tales. Far more like Cinderella, you know, boom, is that right, with the outfit, waving a wand over some terrible situation, and then suddenly you end up with a coach and mice and going to a ball and getting married to a prince or something like that. All those wonderful stories, but unfortunately, that isn't real life. And Jesus was inviting his friends, not part of another story, another fantasy, but something to do with real life. He wasn't inviting to membership of a theme park or a book club, but into a journey into the darkness in the hope of the light. Journey into the unknown, a journey which speaks of change and loss and sacrifice, with signposts written in a foreign language, the language of death and resurrection. And I think it's really clear, but unfashionable to say, that Jesus' followers didn't even believe in resurrection. And that's actually, they were founders of the church. They didn't understand anything about resurrection. They didn't know anything about it at all. They might have been able to say the word, but they had no idea what it was about. And that's why our creeds can be more like a Coke ad or a Christian jingle than anything you'd pack for a life journey. Jesus' followers didn't learn about faith within an institution. They didn't sign up for an online course. They learnt on the job. They learnt on the road. And I think that's exactly the way that we learn. And if you learn things on the road, you'll never ever forget it. That's why I'm wearing this today, you know, because I got this on the road. I threw off the things that I was carrying, and when I met Kevin Flanagan, he showed me something new and I hang on to it like a rabbit's foot. I really do. It reminds me about changing my own direction, which is about repentance. That's all it's all about the possibility of change in a better way. And as I look around, that change is something that continues to need to happen. I see that change in the sort of kindness that people can offer and hospitality that we offer it to each other, and I know about it because I've lived with it. And I've seen it here at St Matthew's. One day there was a man who said, he arrived and said, well, I rang up first. He said, I know some African friends of yours, the Matibis, in Melbourne. And he said, I'm a physiotherapist. I'm actually Indian. But he said, I'm going to be deported if I don't move to a regional centre. And I said, why don't you come and stay with me for a couple of weeks? So he came up here. He stayed with me for a couple of weeks. Then he moved into the Matthews village. He wasn't strictly retirement age, it has to be said, although perhaps he just kept his age well. But I think he was probably about 30. But nevertheless, he came around with me on a Sunday because in that stage I was taking some services at Mount Beauty and Tilangata and all that crowd. So he went up and at the end of the day he said, you know, I've taken communion four times today, which is pretty good for a Hindu. He received this sort of welcome in all of those places that you would just be so proud to have if your own family extended that sort of welcome. It was just perfect. And then, of course, living up at St Matthew's Village, being involved with St Matthew's, and now, of course, he went back to India to get married. I think there were about 3,000 people at his wedding. He's got a beautiful little child. He's living in Melbourne. He's got a great job, and really, it's just so beautiful. But he said to me, I went to a Christian school, but he said, I'm a Hindu. He said, if I became a Christian, my fees would have been free. But he said, that would lack integrity, because I'd only be doing it for the money. And he said, our family is Hindu. He said, you know, if I was brought up in your family, I'd be a Christian. But he said, if you were brought up in mine, you'd be a Hindu. And he said, I try to be the best Hindu I can be. And he said, you try to be the best Christian you can be. But he said, we just need to be the best people we are, wherever we can be. Isn't that wonderful? And that has been a continuing theme. When I was in Sydney last, I was up at the Central Station and I had a particular window into the way that people are cared for. See, here at St Matthew's we say the challenging words, all are invited, all are welcome. All, every single person. We don't ask whether people are Anglican and see their Christian passport stamped. We don't ask whether they go to church all the time. But when I was up at Central Station, there were people who were homeless, as we have here. And they were given a cup of coffee, but only after they'd taken a tract, a sort of turn or burn message. They started this amazing lunch for homeless people once a month. And the idea is you get a homeless person who's just absolutely so desperate they'll even come to a church for food. You sit them down between two people, and while they've got their mouth full, you get someone to Bible bash them. What do you see? That's just another form of abuse. I love the fact that we in Albury don't ask which particular brand someone has, which particular place they were born, because kindness is an international language, and welcome is the most beautiful thing that anyone can ever receive. I had a telephone call 2 minutes before the service this morning from a chap we helped last night to find a place because it was going to rain and he was going to sleep outside. But he came to the church. He said, I'm at your church. This was about 8 o'clock. I'm at your church and no one's there. I said, well, that's because it's 8 o'clock.
but we found him a place for the night. But we didn't ask which particular creed he knew. We didn't ask which religion he belongs to. All he needed to be is a human being made in God's image, who we have the privilege of helping. What more beautiful thing can there be for someone who's a stranger to come to St. Matthew's, see that building, and understand that they should be able to get help there because of the reputation that St. Matthew's has for helping anyone at all. Because religions do cause more trouble than lots of other things. In fact, when I first started working in a church as an ordained minister, I thought that everyone in my congregation in Hillston were widows. It wasn't, it's just that their husbands were Catholics and they felt that if they came into the church, everyone would go to hell together. If you go past the old cemetery up here, you'll see that even when we wouldn't even see dead together, you know? So Catholics there, Anglicans there, everyone else there. And also to understand that as we come in here, that sometimes those divisions can follow people throughout their lives. We go to nursing homes and for our services, and some of them times people haven't been able to go out of the nursing home for years. But the only thing that they've got left from their religious education is they know that if they're a Catholic, they can't join with the rest of us. Or if you're an Anglican, or people say to me, I don't go to church, I'm Church of England. You know. But those divisions, those barriers are absolute hell. And of course, in Holy Week, we remember that the hell of separation is not the last word. That belonging and love and welcome is at the heart of the Christian gospel. Jesus was always welcoming people that others had slammed the door on. And so today, as we think about Harmony Day, we think not just about a word for harmony and getting together. That peace, harmony, peace flame there has covered in dust. Now, we bought it years ago. We really did. And we were told that this is a peace flame, it will make a difference. Well, as time has gone on, I realised that, you know, this sort of thing is a symbol. But lighting all the candles in the world won't make for peace. Peace can only be brought about by justice and understanding and love and compassion and putting your own priorities back there and actually embracing someone else. That is covered in dust. And I hope eventually it becomes a reality, but it will only become a reality if people open their hearts to each other and build the sort of bridges that we need in our world. And it happens from you and for me. In Holy Week, the church is actually get together, you'll be pleased to know. Once a week on Good Friday, and we go around together. Although once we were boycotted, because St. Matthew's, in my person, had supported a marriage equality, and they decided that if I was walking, they wouldn't be, you see. So Father Kevin said to me, don't worry about those stupid buggers. He said, you just walk next to me, you know. And so I thought, well, isn't that the way that life should happen? Walking next to those who will welcome others to open the way for peace and understanding and for the goodwill of all. Oh, what a great message that is. And so this year, when we've been invited to join with that same wonderful congregation up the road at Mate Street on Good Friday after our service here, for we're just joining with them because the rest of them have ducked out. But we've been invited to join them. And so harmony, of course, begins at home. It begins with our own relationships. And of course, if we don't do that, then what are we doing at all? It's wonderful to have our choir singing, and they're going to be singing very shortly a song which was not born in the hymn book. It was born in the experience of someone who was born in America in a time of slavery, John Greenleaf Whittier. He was born at a time when people were treating others in a very different way. In fact, it was said that slaves, you could treat a slave anyway because slaves didn't have souls. So it didn't, it didn't matter. You could treat them in an inhumane way because they said they didn't have souls. He grew up as a Quaker. He self-educated himself. He became the editor of a magazine. He went for Parliament. He started to talk about the abolition of slavery and he was dumped. He started a new office. His office was burnt down. And he kept on going. And in 1865, he lived to see the joy of the 13th Amendment, which was to the abolition of slavery in America. And he wrote, "Dear Lord and Father of mankind, forgive our foolish ways. Reclothe us in a rightful mind. In pure lives thy service find, in deeper reverence praise. In simple trust, like theirs who heard beside the Syrian sea, the gracious calling of the Lord, let us, like them, without a word, rise up and follow thee. Drop thy still dews of quietness till all our striving cease. Take from our souls a strain and stress, and let our ordered lives confess the beauty of thy peace. Happy Harmony Day."
Stand, if we're able, to affirm our faith. The God who creates and is family loves us and tenderly cares for us. The Lord Jesus Christ is our Saviour. He has redeemed us and will defend us to the end. The Lord, the Holy Spirit, is among us. He will lead us in God's holy way. To God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be praise and glory today and forever. Amen. I'd like to be seated as the choir sings, "Dear Lord and Father of Humankind," and I'm sure that John Greenleaf Whittier would be absolutely thrilled at the editorial changes in line with modern compassion. Thank you. that after this service we're having children's church, and it's very good to have some representatives of our young ones here, of course Dexter and Eliza, and they're bringing up offerings that we pray will be used to assist people. And so as people come from many life situations, they need real help, and because of the generosity of our community, we're able to do something about that. So going to, I might get you, can you put those things on here, do you think? That's right, that's a good idea. And while the choir's going to sing, be still for the presence of the Lord. So giving thanks for the spirit of generosity, and also remembering the lives of all those who are reaching out today for help. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God forever. Let us pray.
Let us pray for the world God loves. Through Christ who walks beside us in our Lenten journey, from darkness to light, and for all people according to their needs, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for the variety of races and cultures in Australia and in our community. Enrich our lives by ever-widening circles of friendship and show us your presence in those who differ most from us. Grant that we may always promote the justice and acceptance that ensures lasting peace and racial harmony and mutual respect in our many spiritual traditions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for the gift of service and walking together with others so we can be a greater blessing to your people. We thank you for Kathy Carden and her family, and we pray that you will strengthen her as she uses her many gifts for your greater glory and to be a blessing wherever you lead her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. May our faith grant us strength to walk together in the ways of thankfulness and service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for ourselves and each other, our healthcare workers and those who are isolated, aged, or in challenging circumstances. Also for firefighters, farmers, police, and all God's people, that we might share light, peace, comfort, and joy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the implementation of vaccines across the world and for new ways in which we are connecting. Appreciation for our local communities and all who serve in times of trouble. We pray for unity and understanding in this and every nation, and we pray for those who work for reconciliation. Lord Jesus, who knew the agony of separation, we bring our fears and concerns, difficulties and challenges. Help us to wait in hope and to look for the coming of your kingdom, where all your children are equally loved, valued, and respected. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, you help us to be one in mind, body, and spirit. Give to all your children a new heart to reach out in faith, hope, and love, and to walk gently with others until you bring us all safely home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the silence of our hearts, we bring before God those in special need or distress, especially any known to us. And we pray for those who have recently died, and for those who are remembered with love at this time. Rest eternal grant to them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them.
In these weeks of Lent, give us the faith to share your loving care, protection, and strength, and to find healing and hope. We offer our prayers to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray for peace, justice, and forgiveness as Jesus taught his friends.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Loving God, show us the way so we might see you more clearly, love you more dearly, follow you more nearly, day by day.
You send us into the world we love. Give us grace to go thankfully and with courage in the power of your Spirit. Amen. Now Vicky's going to bring us the notices. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us this morning. This Tuesday is Tunes on Tuesday, and we have Arthur Hull on the voice and being accompanied by our very own Tom Summerfield. Do come along. Tunes on Tuesday is a great thing to have on in the church. You can come and bring your lunch and bring a cup of coffee and just sit here for about 50 minutes. It's on at 10 past one, so this Tuesday. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday service at 9 o'clock. And immediately following that, we'll have our annual parish meeting, so that's about 10:15 a.m. It'll be fairly quick, so you can come along and join in, but we promise not to put you on parish council. If you have any items for general business, they need to be emailed to the office, so office at stmatthewsaubrey.com, or taken to Kay before noon tomorrow. Tomorrow's the deadline to get those general business items there. The Mothers Union Annual Quiet Day is following Wednesday on the 31st. And the details of Holy Week you'll find on the pew sheet. Thank you, everyone.
Also yesterday, between 9:30 and 12, we auditioned a number of people for scholarships for St Matthew's Music Association for Country Kids. And it was really wonderful to see those young people and the opportunities we're going to be able to give them. So again, we're really looking forward to them perhaps getting perhaps more musical opportunities and all sorts of things we're going to be doing as we think about the gift that music is. And so grateful to our musicians that we have up here. Aren't we fortunate? We're the envy of the universe, I think, in having the music that we have here. And so to share the musical gift is something that's really very special as well. Now we have our final hymn. Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing. Thank you.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We open our hearts to receive God's blessing. May God bless us and hold us close. May God's light shine for us and from us and those whom we pray. And God's love be with us always. And give us peace. And may the blessing of God the Father, the grace of God the Son, and the friendship of God the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us, and those we love and those for whom we pray, today and always. Amen.
Go in peace as we continue to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.